So this is the question, why do we have to die? How to overcome death? So what exactly is death? Krishna explained that in the beginning of the verse of the Bhagavad Gita. Explains it here. The very beginning of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna highlighted this point. Dehi nosmi yata dehe kaumaram yavanam jara tata dehanta prati dhirastatta muhyate. So he says here that the embodied soul continuously passes in this body from boyhood to youth to old age. The soul similarly passes to another body and death. So a sober person is not bewildered by such a change. So the soul, the first lesson that we learn, that we as soul, we are not subject to death. But whatever body we take, that is subject to death. See? The boyhood to youth to old age, the soul similarly passes to another body at death. That means the soul doesn't die, but the body dies. Whichever body it takes, it will die. And the body goes through this nine form of transformation. So it goes through birth, I mean before birth there's inception. It goes through this these nine stages actually. Impregnation, gestation, birth, infancy, childhood, youth, middle age, old age, and death are the nine ages of the body. So this is the transformation in the body and death. You see this? So death is something that, as Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, it's like this. Can you want to read that, please, for me?
Yeah, Prabhu. As a person puts on new garments, giving up old ones, the soul similarly accepts new material bodies, giving up the old and useless ones.
So this is the position of the soul, you know. The body is subject to destruction. But the soul is not. Explain here again. I can read on.
One who has taken his birth is sure to die, and after death, what is sure to take birth again. Therefore, in the unavoidable discharge of your duty, you should not lament.
So this is the position of the living entity who have taken birth. And no one in the material world can escape from this. It's here. The topmost living entity to... See here.
from the highest planet in the material world down to the lowest, all are places of misery wherein repeated births and death take place. But one who attains my abode, O son of Kunti, never takes birth again.
So one who doesn't take birth again doesn't die again, for sure. So the point is this, that here, from the highest planet to the lowest planet, from the highest planet, the material world, down to the lowest, all are places of misery wherein repeated birth and death take place. In other words, this material world, every living entity takes birth and every living entity dies, you know. So it is not that no one, you know, dies, so no one can achieve this platform, you know. Surprisingly, I think it was Hiranyakashipu, no? What chapter is that? He went to Brahma to ask to become immortal. Anyone knows that? He went to Lord Brahma and said, I want to become immortal. No? And Lord Brahma says, even I have to die. How can I give you immortality? So then he very cleverly wanted to become immortal. So he asked a benediction that I cannot be killed in the day, I cannot kill in the night.
Canto 7, chapter 3.
What verse?
This one is
so he said, I don't want to die, you know. I want to be free from death. So he says what he says, you know.
37.
So he praises Lord Brahma. So here it says here. Oh my Lord, best of the giver benediction. If you will kindly grant me this benediction, I desire, please let me not meet death from any living entities created by you. See this point here? I desire benediction not to meet death, no? So you see how that he wants to escape death, you know? So every living entity know that this is very painful, you know? And nobody wants to die. That is the point here. And of course, then he wanted to meet death, you know, he wanted to escape from death. So this is another incident where he tried to escape from death in a roundabout way, you know. Grant me that I don't die within any residence or outside, any resident during daytime or night, no, in the ground, on the sky. Grant me that my death not be brought about by any being created by someone other than you. Nor by any weapon, nor by any human being or animal. See? So you see how he is trying to ask for benediction that nobody can, no death can give me, kill me. And grant me that I not meet death from any living entity, living or non-living. Grant me further that I not be killed by any demigod or demon, by any great snake from lower planets. Since no one can kill you in the battlefield, you have no competitor. Therefore, grant me the benediction that I too may have no rival. Give me sole lordship over all the living entities, presiding deities, and give me all the glories obtained by that position. Furthermore, give me all the mystic powers attained by long austerity and practice of yoga, for this loss, this cannot be lost at any time. So you see how he's asking again a benediction that he fully covered, you know. So see how this, even a great personality like Hiranyakashipu is also frightened of death. So death, you cannot overcome the this thing, you see, because then I'm sure you know the story how the Lord came as Narasimha Dev and he killed him. It's not possible to escape from death, you know. So it's explained here also. You can see here in this verse. That how can see and give me a little time. So here. So even a clever, you know, living entity like Hiranyakashipu with all his austerity, a living entity is trying his very best, you know, to become happy. Can you read, please?
Yeah. It is observed within the material world that sometimes even an intelligent person is not happy. Similarly, sometimes even a great fool is happy. The concept of becoming happy through through expertly performing material activities is simply a useless exhibition of false egotism.
So everybody is trying to become happy, you know. So you read on.
Even if people know how to achieve happiness and avoid unhappiness, they still do not know the process by which death will not be able to exert its power over them.
So you understand this? So although they are trying to become happy, and let's say they become happy, but still they cannot overcome death. Yes. And death is not, you know, at all pleasing. See,
death is not at all pleasing, and since everyone is exactly like a condemned man being led to the place of execution, what possible happiness can people derive from material objects or the gratification they provide?
But the moment you know you're going to die, what happiness you can derive from all your wealth, your health, your so-called position, correct? So rather than trying to find a solution to solve this biggest problem, death, to hide away from it, it is not exactly intelligent, you know. What is the use of doing everything so nicely only to end in destruction, in death? So therefore, an intelligent person of the Shastra say, Ataha, now you got this human birth. You should find a solution for this birth, death, and disease. That is the intelligent use of this human life, you know. This intelligent use of the human life is to figure out how to stop this nonsense, rather than trying to hide away from it. Therefore, is human birth, you know, one who has got this human birth. Read on.
Amrita Mataji, can you go ahead and read?
Hare Krishna, Prabhupada. A human being who is wise should never desire promotion to heavenly planets or residence in hell. Indeed, a human being should also never desire permanent residence on earth, for by which absorption in the material body, one becomes foolishly negligent of one's actual self-interest.
That she never desire promotion to heaven or resident in hell. Nobody wants that anyway. Indeed, a human being should never desire permanent resident even in earth. For such absorption in the body, material body, one become foolishly negligent of one's self-interest. Right? And what is that self-interest? Hmm? Can you read on?
A wise person, knowing that although the material body is subject to death, it can still award the perfection of one's life, should not foolishly neglect to take advantage of this opportunity before death arrives.
So because the human body has got the facility to overcome this problem of death, but it cannot overcome this death by trying to do all kind of activities like yoga or trying to go and meditate in some big forest or trying to speculate and trying to escape it. No. The only way this living entity can overcome death is to take shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. It's the only way. Please read.
Knowing that one's duration of life is being similarly cut down by the passing of days and nights, one should be shaken by fear. In this way, giving up all material attachment and desire, one understands the Supreme Lord and achieves perfect peace.
So unless one takes shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, there's no way you can come out of this problem. You know, you can see here, it is explained again. Many times we have shown this verse. Huh? See, unless you take, for one who has taken shelter of the Lord, please read.
Thus, the devotee who worships me, the all-pervading Lord of the universe, is unflinching devotional service, gives up all aspirations to be promoted to heavenly planets or to become happy in this world with wealth, children, cattle, home, or anything in relationship with the body. I take him to the other side of birth and death.
So you see here, so those devotees, you know, them a devotee who worships me. Does the devotee who worships me, only he can overcome this problem of birth and death. Just now we saw the story of Hiranyakashipu. He tried very hard without being a devotee of Krishna. He wanted to actually escape death. But Lord Brahma says it's not possible. And he tried in a roundabout way, trying to say, I cannot be killed in the day, in the night, inside, outside, upstairs, downstairs. I cannot be killed by any human being, animal, demigod. He tried all his things. But he was killed. So, see, so this is again a very important point. The Lord says here again. Can you read on?
The terrible fear of birth and death can never be forsaken by anyone who resorts to any shelter other than myself. For I am the Almighty Lord, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the original source of all creation, and also the Supreme Soul of all souls.
So you see that here, the terrible fear of birth and death can never be forsaken by anyone who resorts to any other shelter than myself. You cannot escape this, you know. It's not possible. You can try anything, but it's not possible to overcome. So try to understand how this death is something that until and unless one surrenders to Krishna, then only, yes, he can overcome. See here, only when you can go to any planet, you can try going anywhere. See that?
No one in this material world has become free from the four principles of birth, death, old age, and disease, even by fleeing to the various planets. But now that you have appeared, my Lord, death is fleeing in fear of you and the living entity.
Someone else can take over. Hello. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, Prabhu.
Can you read on?
Having obtained shelter at your lotus feet by your mercy, are sleeping in full mental peace.
So only by taking shelter of the Lord, that you can overcome this problem of birth and death. There's no other solution. It cannot be solution. I explain here also. Yeah, apanam samsritim goram.
Living beings who are entangled in the complicated meshes of birth and death can be freed immediately by even unconsciously chanting the holy name of Krishna, which is feared by fear personified.
So please read the purport.
Vasudeva, or Lord Krishna, the absolute personality of Godhead, is the supreme controller of everything, and as such he is feared by all others. There is no one in creation who is not afraid of the rage of the Almighty. Great asuras like Ravan, Hiranyakashipu, Kamsa, and others who were very powerful living entities were all killed by the personality of Godhead, and the Almighty Vasudeva has empowered his name with the powers of his personal self. Everything directly related to him is identical with him. It is stated herein that the name of Krishna is feared even by fear personified. This indicates that the name of Krishna is non-different from Krishna. Therefore, the name of Krishna is as powerful as Lord Krishna himself. There is no difference. There is no difference at all. Anyone, therefore, can take advantage of the holy names of Lord Sri Krishna even in the midst of the greatest danger. The transcendental name of Krishna, even though uttered unconsciously or by force of circumstances, can help one obtain freedom from the huddle of birth and death.
So you can see how you can escape death. There's a way to escape death by taking only one way, that is to take shelter of Krishna. See? Can be free immediately by unconsciously even chanting the holy name of Krishna. So this process is the most powerful process. That if you want to escape death, then you have to take hold of Krishna. As Krishna says, there's no other way. No one can find any other way to escape this death until and unless they surrender to me. And Krishna also said in the Bhagavad Gita, you know, this terrible modes of material nature, they are difficult to overcome. But those who surrender to me only can overcome this Maya. Yes. Please read.
Thanks, Amrita Mataji, for reading. Diksha Mataji, can you come in?
Hare Krishna Prabhu, yes. Shall I read, Prabhu?
Yes, Mataji.
This divine energy of mind consisting of the three modes of material nature is difficult to overcome, but those who have surrendered unto me can easily cross beyond it.
See here again. Right. But those who have surrendered unto me can easily cross behind it, beyond it. So the criteria is to surrender. So therefore, this material world, we can conclude that this material world, we can conclude that there's no way out of this. It is designed in such a way that this birth, death, old age, disease are obstacles placed. And no one can overcome this obstacle unless only on one ground, that is to take shelter of Krishna. You know. And also Krishna says also here.
The real problem of life is the repetition of birth and death, which is like a wheel rolling repeatedly up and down. This wheel, however, completely stops when one is in touch with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In other words, by the transcendental bliss realized from constant engagement in devotional service, one is completely liberated from material existence. All learned men know this. Therefore, my dear friends, O son of the Asuras, immediately begin meditating upon and worshipping the super soul within everyone's heart.
So here, this is another point made by Prahlad Maharaj, you know. He says that it's not, that's not, we say, unconsciously chanting, you can stop this cycle of birth and death. So if you come somehow or other in touch with the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the wheel immediately stops, completely stops. See? So try to understand that our real problem is not food or lack of sleep or some lack of money or no. Our real problem is how to overcome this birth and death. That is the thing. The human being who has taken birth, ataha, brahma jikyashaha. So only when you come into the platform of realizing that you're Brahman, spirit, soul, and servant of Krishna, that is the purpose of human life, then this cycle of birth and death will immediately stop. There's no more, you know, going through it over and over again. That is the success of human life, you know. This is what it is all about. When you try to worry about this, I've got no this, I've no that, it's all a petty thing, you know. Because all these things will come and go, you know, materially speaking. There's always going to be some kind of a problem. As Krishna said to Arjuna. What is that? 14, is it? Support the Matras Pasta Sukhaunte, yeah? Yeah, next verse. Yeah. Can you read this, please?
O son of Kunti, the non-permanent appearance of this verse.
I just want to find out the calendar for.
O son of Kunti, the non-permanent appearance of happiness and distress and their disappearance in due course are like the appearance and disappearance of winter and summer season. They arise from sense perception. O Sishan of Bharat, and one must learn to tolerate them without being disturbed.
So this is another thing we have to learn, because this death is very, very painful. But we have to learn how to, you know, tolerate this material world. There's going to be so many issues, problem created by our mind, problem created by other people's mind, problem created by the demigods. All this is, that's why Krishna says, a place of misery. And not only misery, this place is full of danger at every step, you know. Padam padam bi padam na tesham. It's not a place that is very safe, you know. Place is dangerous at every step. But this dangerous place becomes safe. Can you read?
For one who has accepted the boat of lotus feet of the Lord, who is the shelter of the cosmic manifestation and is famous as Mukunda or the giver of Mukti, the portion of material world is like the water contained in half footprint. Param Padam, or the place where there are no material miseries, or Vaikuntha, is his goal, not the place where there is danger in every step of life.
Is that? So when we take shelter of the Lord, then we get this boat to cross over this cycle of birth and death. So if anybody try to take any other shelter besides this, it's not going to work. It will never work. That's why in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna also said, abandon all varieties of religion and just surrender to me. Why he said that? Because there's no other recourse. You cannot try to do anything else and succeed. It's not possible. See?
Abandon all varieties of religion and just surrender unto me. I shall deliver you from all sinful reaction. Do not fear. Thus the Lord takes all responsibility for one who surrenders unto him, and he indemnifies such a person against all reactions of sin.
You understand? That's why he says here that he says here, na chirat. Very quickly, he says, not after, very quickly. Can you read this?
But those who worship me, giving up all their activities unto me and being devoted to me without deviation, engaged in devotional service and always meditating upon me, having fixed their minds upon me, or O son of Pritha, for them I am the swift deliverer from the ocean of birth and death.
Yes, you can see this happened to many souls. One, I'm sure you know the story of Ajamil, when he unconsciously chanted the name of his son, right? Yes, then the Yamadutas came and they stopped the Yamadutas came to take him away, correct? Yes. And he chanted because he saw the Yamadutas, he chanted with the name of his son who was not far away. He called for his sons. He chanted the name of Narayan. He saw the Yamadutas and he chanted. Because death, you know, Yamadutas means they come to take him away. Can you read, please?
Ajamil then saw three awkward persons with deformed bodily feature, fierce, twisted faces, and hair standing erect on their bodies. With ropes in their hand, they had come to take him away to the abode of Yamraj. When he saw them, he was extremely bewildered. And because of attachment to his child, who was playing a short distance away, Ajamil began to call him loudly by his name. Thus, with tears in his eye, he somehow or other chanted the holy name of Narayan.
That he saw them and he chanted the name of Narayan unconsciously because he was calling his son. He was not even referring to the actual Narayan. See what happens.
My dear king, the order carriers of Vishnu Dut, immediately arrived when they heard the holy name of their master from the mouth of the dying Ajamil, who had certainly chanted without offense because he had chanted in complete anxiety.
You can see here, those devotees in Vaikuntha, they arrived immediately, you know. Understand? It didn't take some time for them to come. So it is not that, you know, the Lord, you know, some time gap to chant his name and to wait. No. Immediately they arrived there. And what they do?
The order carrier of Yamraj were snatching the soul from the core of the heart of Ajamil, the husband of prostitute, but with resounding voices, the messengers of Lord Vishnu, Vishnu Duta, forbade them to do so.
So immediately they stopped the Yamadutas from taking Ajamil, pulling his soul out of his body with ropes, you know. And this Ajamil, he was terrified because this is a situation of death. People want to know what happens at death. This is what happens. If you are a sinful person, you will see the agents of Yamaraj. They will come. And when they come, you are so frightened, you will be passing urine and stool. And they will be pulling your soul out. And immediately they cover your soul with another body, a blanket, a can of another body, subtle body. And then within minutes, you are transported to Yamaloka. This is what happens if you are going to death, if you are going to hell. Oh, very terrifying. So immediately, the agents of Krishna, Vishnu Dutas, they came and said, no, you cannot do it. And then there was a talk between them. See, this man is very sinful. See, it says nobody can stop the order of Yamaraj. How is that you are challenging our master's authority? Who are you? See that? Then, can you read on?
Dear sir, whose servants are you? Where have you come from? And why are you forbidding us to touch the body of Ajamil? Are you demigod from the heavenly planet? Are you sub-demigod? Or are you the best of devotees?
Purport.
The most significant word used in this verse is Siddha Satamaha, which means the best of the perfect. In Bhagavad Gita 7.3, it is said, Manushya Nam Sahistreshu Kashyad Yatati Siddhaya. Out of millions of persons, one may try to become Siddha, perfect. Or in other words, self-realized. A self-realized person knows that he is not the body, but a spiritual soul, Aham Brahmasmi. At the present moment, practically everyone is unaware of this fact. But one who understands this has attained perfection and is called Siddha. When one understands that the soul is part and parcel of the Supreme Soul, and one thus engages in the devotional service of the Supreme Soul, one becomes Siddha Sat Tama. One is then eligible to live in the Vaikunth planets or Krishna Loka. The word Siddha Satamaha therefore refers to a liberated pure devotee. Since the Yamaduta are servants of Yamraj, who is also one of the Siddha Satamas, they knew that Siddha Satamaha is above the demigod and sub-demigod and indeed above all the living entities within this material world. The Yamaduta therefore inquired why the Vishnu Dut were present where a sinful man was going to die. It should also be noted that Ajamil was not yet dead, for the Yamaduta were trying to snatch the soul from his heart. They could not take the soul, however, and therefore Ajamil was not yet dead. This will be revealed in later verses. Ajamil was simply in an unconscious state when the argument was in process between the Yamaduta and Vishnuduta. The conclusion of the argument was to be decision regarding who would claim the soul of Ajamil.
Read on.
The order carrier of Yamraj said, your eyes are just like the petal of lotus flower, dressed in yellow silken garment, decorated with garments of lotuses and wearing very attractive helmets on your head and earring on your ears. You all appear fresh and youthful. Your four long arms are decorated with bows and quivers of arrows and with sword, club, conch shell, disc and lotus flower. Your effulgence has dissipated the darkness of this place with extraordinary illumination. Now, sir, why are you obstructing us?
So you can see how there was a talk between them, and Ajamil heard this talk, no? Right? So they stopped him from taking the soul, Ajamil, because he chanted the name of God. So of course, this is a very fortunate position, Ajamil. Some or other, he got his son name as Narayan. And the last moment, he called his son, not knowing that he was calling for the Lord. And because he chanted the name of God, the Vishnudutas came and saved him, you know. So this is the position of how to escape death. Oh. Not only here, there is also another story whereby, you know, an elephant named Gajendra, he was also put in a difficult position. He was attacked by a crocodile. And the crocodile was, you know, in the process of going to devour him, because he was, although elephant is very strong, but in the water is not as strong as a crocodile. So he was finished, you know. He says, I'm finished now. My dear Lord, now you please save me. You see? And you can see here the crocodile chanted Narayana Akhila Guru Bhagavan Namaste. He chanted this prayer at the time of, you know, his almost, you know, difficult position. See, can you read?
Diksha Mataji, thanks for reading. Vivek Prabhu, can you take over? Vivek.
After understanding the covered and condition of Gajendra, who had offered his prayers, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari, who lives everywhere, appeared with the demigods who were offering prayers to him, carrying his disc and other weapons. He appeared there on the back of his carrier, Garuda, with great speed. According to his desires, thus he appears before Gajendra.
So you can see here in this time, just now we read that how the Vishnu Dutas came to save Ajamil. Here this Gajendra is an elephant, was fighting in the water with his crocodile. I think you know the story, right? You know the story, I'm sure, isn't it? Not?
Yes, sir.
So he was helpless, was going to die, you know. He says that I am finished. I have no more desire to live. Huh? You understand? He says here, you can see, he was attacked by this crocodile and he says, I don't want to live anymore. Hmm? Can you read? Can someone read?
I do not wish to live anymore. After I am releasing from the attack of the crocodile, what is the use of an elephant's body covered externally and internally by ignorance? If I simply desire internal liberation from the covering of ignorance, that covering is not destroyed by the influence of time.
So you see how he doesn't want to live anymore. He wants to go. So this is one fortunate thing, is that he remembered all these prayers, because he was cursed to become an elephant. In his previous life, he was King Indrajumna, and he was actually, he learned all the prayers, you know, to Krishna. So you see, therefore, it is explained that how important it is to learn all these prayers for the Lord, you know. Because even though he didn't make it in previous life, because this was an unfortunate thing, or fortunate thing that he became an elephant, but he did not forget all the prayers that he learned in his previous life, you know. So then he started chanting all these prayers in praise of the Lord. And in this way, he got the mercy of the Lord, no? So therefore, it is very important that in this situation, how the Lord did not waste time in coming to save him, you know? Understand? The Lord came immediately. Can you read on?
Thanks, Prabhu.
Gajendra had been forcefully captured by the crocodile in the water and was feeling acute pain. But when he saw the Narayan wielding his disc was coming in the sky on the back of Garuda, he immediately took a lotus flower in his trunk, and with great difficulty, due to his painful condition, he uttered the following words: "O my Lord Narayan, Narayana, Master of the Universe, O Supreme Personality of Godhead, I offer my respectful obeisance unto you."
So here he said this prayer, you know. He said in this line, just now he chanted Narayan Ajamil. Here Gajendra, he said, Narayana Akhila Guru Bhagavan Namaste. Chanted this mantra. And the Lord appeared immediately, pulled him out of the water, cut the head of the crocodile. Immediately, it was instantaneous, you know. So you see how to escape birth and death here. Can you read on, please, the purport? Someone can read?
Yeah, thanks, Vivek Prabhu, for reading. Divya Mataji, can you continue?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. The king of the elephants was so very eager to see the Supreme Personality of Godhead that when he saw the Lord coming in the sky with great pain and in a feeble voice, he offered respect to the Lord. A devotee does not consider a dangerous position to be dangerous, for in such dangerous position, he can fervently pray to the Lord in great ecstasy. Thus, a devotee regards danger as a good opportunity. When a devotee is in great danger, he sees that danger to be the great mercy of the Lord because it is an opportunity to think of the Lord very sincerely and with undiverted attention. Prabhuji, can you please call them? He does not accuse the Supreme Personality of Godhead for having let his devotee fall into such a dangerous condition. Rather, he considers the dangerous condition to be due to his past misdeeds and takes it as an opportunity to pray to the Lord and offer thanks for having been given such an opportunity. When a devotee lives in this way, his salvation, his going back home, back to Godhead, is guaranteed. We can see this to be true from the example of Gajendra, who anxiously prayed to the Lord and thus received an immediate chance to return home back to Godhead.
So you see here, this is what happens, you know. Immediately he got freed. And then you see, he immediately went, he was carried away.
Thereafter, seeing Gajendra in such an aggrieved position, the unborn Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari, immediately got down from the back of Garuda by his causeless mercy and pulled the king of the elephants along with the crocodile out of the water. Then, in the presence of all the demigods who were looking on, the Lord severed the crocodile's mouth from its body with his disc. In this way, he saved Gajendra, the king of the elephants.
You see how immediately he pulled them out of the water, cut the head of the crocodile, and touched the body of Gajendra. He got his four-handed form. And with his four-handed form, he took him back to the spiritual world. Understand? So try to understand how the Lord is not, you know, anyway, not conscious of the living entity. He is in the heart of all living entities and is very conscious. And it's not that, you know, he takes a long time to save someone. No. There's also the case of Parikshit Maharaj when he was in the womb of his mother. Aswatthama, he released the Brahmastra to kill the embryo. But the Lord, he was in the womb of Uttara. He came out in four-handed form and he protected the little the embryo of Parikshit Maharaj, saved him. So try to understand, you know, that not that God is very, very far away. He is also very near. I think it's the Ishvapanishad mantra, no?
Although fixed in his abode, the personality of Godhead is swifter than the mind and can overcome all others running. The powerful demigods cannot approach him. Although in one place he controls those who supply the air and rain, he surpasses all in excellence.
So you see how the Lord is, you know, he's very close. Although far, he's also near.
The Supreme Lord walks and does not walk. He is far away, but he is very near as well. He is within everything and yet he is outside of everything.
This is inconceivable. Achinta Beda Beda Tattva. Simultaneously one and different. So although he is far away in Vaikuntha planet, nobody can go there. But he's also very near. He's situated in the heart of everybody. He's within everything. So therefore, if anyone is intelligent, why have to take shelter of him at the time of death? You should take shelter of the Lord now itself. Correct? Yes?
Yes, Prabhupada.
If you know the way out of this whole mess is to take shelter of the lotus feet of the Lord, then why not do it immediately? Why you have to wait until the time of death? And who knows at the time of death with so many tubes and this thing in the body, whether you will be able to remember him? That's a big question. It says here, although,
terrified, about to die, a man collapses on his bed. Although his voice is faltering and he's hardly conscious of what he is saying, if he utters the holy name of the Supreme Lord, he can be freed from the reaction of his fruitive work and achieve the supreme destination. But still, people in the age of Kali will not worship the Supreme Lord.
This is the point. You understand? Particularly, most of them don't even know. To know, you need piety, no? To know that God, Krishna, is the Supreme Personality of Godhead itself is a very, it's not such a cheap thing. It's explained after many, many births. Then one who knows that I am all in all. Such a person is a great and rare soul. Krishna says, Bahunam Janmanam Ante. Jnanavan mam prapatyate Vasudevam sarvamiti. You know that Vasudev, Krishna is everything, all in all. Such a person is a Mahatma and Sudurlabha. It says here, can you read?
After many births and deaths, he who is actually in knowledge surrenders unto me, knowing me to be the cause of all causes and all that is. Such a great soul is very rare.
Yes, see? If you know that Krishna is everything, just to know, you are a great and rare soul. And if you know also his transcendental leelas, Krishna again says, this is said in the fourth chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, he says, if you know, then you also escape the cycle of birth and death. Janma karma cha midivyam evam yoveti tatpataha. Taktva deham punarjanma naite mameti sojuna.
One who knows the transcendental nature of my appearance and activities does not, upon leaving the body, take his birth again in this material world, but attains my eternal abode, O Arjuna.
Again, one who knows my birth and activities,
My appearance and activities.
My appearance and activities. He does not take birth again when he quits his body. So this is the whole idea of this whole life in this material world. If you want to carry on your so-called material life, then you cannot get this facility to come out. And if you are serious about coming out of this material world and you had enough, just like the elephant says, I do not wish to live anymore. I am tired and sick of this world. So unless one is disgusted of this material world, then this question of coming out of material world does not exist. If someone wants to be attached to so-called family, children, all kind of other material activities, then there's no question of trying to come out. Therefore, if one is serious about coming out, he must feel disgusted. I am sick, you know, I don't want any more to do with this material world. I'm enough. So he has to feel like that, you know. You understand? So we think that, oh, it's very nice, you know, I want to stay here and enjoy this life, then yes, Krishna will make all arrangements for you to forget the suffering, so-called suffering, and enjoy, you know.
A transcendentalist, having become disgusted and hopeless in all endeavors for material happiness, completely controls the senses and develops detachment. By spiritual practice, he should then fix the mind on the spiritual platform without deviation.
This is the solution. First, he has to become disgusted. Then he had to take up the process of detachment. And this can be done by spiritual practice. The spiritual practice means, it means this.
Until one's mind. When a person is disgusted with the temporary, illusory nature of this world and is thus detached from it, his mind, guided by the instructions of his spiritual master, considers again and again the nature of this world and eventually gives up the false identification with matter.
You understand this one? So his mind has to be guided by the instruction of the spiritual master. In other words, if you want to escape the cycle of birth and death, you must have a spiritual master to take you out with the knowledge to understand all this instruction of the Lord and surrender to the Lord. Surrendering to the Lord is not some one-day affair. You know? It has to be practiced. Satata kitayanto mam yatantascha drdhavataha namasyantascha mam bhaktya nitya yukta upashate. Then you can do this eternally by constantly hearing and chanting about the Lord. This is the process. That's why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has given us the very easy way in Kali Yuga, that you please chant Hare Krishna. So he says, he says here,
simply by chanting the holy name of Krishna, one can obtain freedom from material existence. Indeed, simply by chanting the Hare Krishna mantra, one will be able to see the lotus feet of the Lord.
This is the only process to chant Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. If you can do this, yes, you can see. Very quickly you become detached. Can you read this?
In his Anubhashya, Sri Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami says that the actual effect that will be visible as soon as one achieves transcendental knowledge is that he will immediately become free from the clutches of Maya and fully engage in the service of the Lord. Unless one serves the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Mukunda, one cannot become free from fruitive activities under the external energy. However, when one chants the holy name of the Lord offenselessly, one can realize a transcendental position that is completely aloof from the material conception of life. Rendering service to the Lord, a devotee relates to the Supreme Personality of Godhead in one of five relationships, namely Santa, Dasya, Sakya, Vatsalya, or Madhurya. And thus he relishes transcendental bliss in that relationship. Such a relationship certainly transcends the body and mind. When one realizes that the holy name of the Lord is identical with the Supreme Person, he becomes completely eligible to chant the holy name of the Lord. Such an ecstatic chanter and dancer must be considered to have a direct relationship with the Lord. According to the Vedic principles, there are three stages of spiritual advancement, namely Sambandha Jnana, Abhideya, and Prayojana. Sambandha Jnana refers to re-establishing one's relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Abhideya refers to acting according to that constitutional relationship. And Prayojana is the ultimate goal of life, which is to develop love of Godhead. If one adheres to the regulative principles under the order of the spiritual master, he very easily achieves the ultimate goal of his life. A person who is addicted to the chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra very easily gets the opportunity to serve the Supreme Personality of Godhead directly. There is no need for such a person to understand the grammatical jugglery in which Mayavadi sannyasis generally indulge. Sri Shankaracharya also stressed this point. Simply by juggling grammatical suffixes and prefixes, one cannot save himself from the clutches of death. The grammatical word jugglers cannot bewilder a devotee who engages in chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. Simply addressing the energy of the Supreme Lord as Hare and the Lord himself as Krishna very soon situates the Lord within the heart of the devotee. By thus addressing Radha and Krishna, one directly engages in his Lordship's service. The essence of all revealed scriptures and all knowledge is present when one addresses the Lord and his energy by the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, for this transcendental vibration can completely liberate a conditioned soul and directly engage him in the service of the Lord. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu presented himself as a grand fool, yet he maintained that all the words that he had heard from his spiritual master strictly followed the principles stated by Vyasadeva in Srimad Bhagavatam. The material miseries of a living entity, which are superfluous to him, can be directly mitigated by the linking process of devotional service. But the mass of people do not know this. And therefore, the learned Vyasadeva compiled this Vedic literature, Srimad Bhagavatam, which is in relation to the Supreme Truth. One can overcome all misconceptions and entanglement in the material world by practicing Bhakti Yoga. And therefore, Vyasadeva, acting on the instruction of Sri Narada, has very kindly introduced Srimad Bhagavatam to relieve the conditioned souls from the clutches of Maya. Lord Chaitanya's spiritual master instructed him. Instructed him, therefore, that one must read Srimad Bhagavatam regularly and with scrutiny to gradually become attached to the chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. The holy name and the Lord are identical. One who is completely free from the clutches of Maya can understand this fact. The knowledge which is achieved by the mercy of the spiritual master places one on the supreme transcendental platform. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu presented himself as a fool because prior to accepting the shelter of a spiritual master, he could not understand that simply. By chanting, one can be relieved from all material conditions. But as soon as he became a faithful servant of his spiritual master and followed his instructions, he very easily saw the path of liberation. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra must be understood to be devoid of all offenses. The 10 offenses against the holy name are as follows: to blaspheme a devotee of the Lord, to consider the Lord and the demigods to be on the same level, or to think that there are many gods, to neglect the orders of the spiritual master, to minimize the authority of scriptures, Vedas, to interpret the holy name of God, to commit sins on the strength of chanting, to instruct the glories of the Lord's name to the unfaithful, to compare the chanting of the holy name with a material piety, to be inattentive while chanting the holy name, and to be attached to material things in spite of chanting the holy name.
So you see how how you can escape simply by chanting Krishna name.
In this age of Kali, there is no religious principle other than the chanting of the holy name, which is the essence of all Vedic hymns. That is, this is the purport of all scriptures.
Read the
purport.
Yeah.
The principles of the Parampara system were strictly honored in previous ages, Satya Yuga, Treta Yuga, and Dwapara Yuga. But in the present age, Kali Yuga, people neglect the importance of this system of Shrauta Parampara or receiving knowledge by disciplic succession. In this age, people are prepared to argue that they can understand that which is beyond their limited knowledge and perception through so-called scientific observations and experiments, not knowing that actual truth comes down to man from authorities. This argumentative attitude is against the Vedic principles, and it is very difficult for one who adapts it to. Understand that the holy name of Krishna is as good as Krishna himself. Since Krishna and his holy name are identical, the holy name is eternally pure and beyond material contamination. It is a supreme personality of Godhead as a transcendental vibration. The holy name is completely different from material sound, as confirmed by Narottama Dasa Thakura. The transcendental vibration of Harinama Sankirtana is imported from the spiritual world. Thus, although materialists who are addicted to experiment knowledge and the so-called scientific method cannot place their faith in the chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, it is a fact that simply by chanting the Hare Krishna Mantra offenselessly, one can be freed from all subtle and gross material conditions. The spiritual world is called Vaikuntha, which means without anxiety. In the material world, everything is full of anxiety, Kunta. Whereas in the spiritual world, Vaikuntha, everything is free from anxiety. Therefore, those who are afflicted by a combination of anxieties cannot understand the Hare Krishna mantra, which is free from all anxiety. In the present age, the vibration of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra is the only process that is in a transcendental position beyond material contamination. Since the holy name can deliver a conditioned soul, it is explained here to be Sarva Mantra Sara, the essence of all Vedic hymns. A name that represents an object of this material world may be subjected to arguments and experimental knowledge. But in the absolute world, a name and its owner, the fame and the famous, are identical. And similarly, the qualities, pastimes, and everything else pertaining to this absolute are also absolute. Although Mayavadis profess monism, they differentiate between the holy name of the Supreme Lord and the Supreme Lord himself. For this offense of Namaparada, they gradually glide down from their exalted position of Brahma Jnana as confirmed in Srimad Bhagavatam. Although by severe austerities, they rise to the exalted position of Brahma Jnana, they nevertheless fall down due to imperfect knowledge of the absolute truth. Although they profess to understand the Vedic mantra, Sarvam Kala Idam Brahmam Chandogya, which means everything is Brahman, they are unable to understand that the holy name is also Brahman. If they regularly chant the Maha Mantra, however, they can be relieved from this misconception. Unless one properly takes shelter of the holy name, he cannot be relieved from the offensive stage in chanting the holy name. After describing the potency of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, my spiritual master taught me another verse, advising me to always keep it within my throat.
You want to say something?
No, Prabhu. Actually, I thought let other read. But yeah.
Hare Nama, Hare Nama, Hare Nama, Eva Kevalam, Kalao Nashteva, 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 Gatiranyataha.
Thanks, Deva Mataji. Now, request Gopishwari Mataji to...
Yes, Prabhu. Translation. For spiritual progress in this age of Kali, there is no alternative. There is no alternative. There is no alternative to the holy name. The holy name, the holy name of the Lord. Purport. For progress in spiritual life, the Shastras recommend meditation in Satya Yuga, sacrifice for the satisfaction of Lord Vishnu in the Treta Yuga, and gorgeous worship of the Lord in the temple in Dwapar Yuga. But in the age of Kali, one can achieve spiritual progress only by chanting the holy name of the Lord. This is confirmed in various scriptures. In Srimad Bhagavatam, there are many references to this fact. In the 12th canto, it is said, Kaler dosha nidhe rajan asti heko mahan guna kirtana deva krishnasya mukta sanga param vrajet. In the age of Kali, there are many faults, for people are subjected to many miserable conditions. Yet in this age, there is one great benediction. Simply by chanting the Hare Krishna mantra, one can be freed from all material contamination and thus be elevated to the spiritual world. The Narada Pancharatra also praises the Hare Krishna Maha mantra as follows. The essence of all Vedic knowledge, comprehending the three kinds of Vedic activity, Karma Kanda, Jnana Kanda, and Upasana Kanda, the Chandas or Vedic hymns are and the processes for satisfying the demigods, is included in the eight syllables of Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. This is the reality of all Vedanta. The chanting of the holy name is the only means to cross the ocean of nescience. Similarly, the Kali Santarana Upanishad states, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. These 16 names composed of 32 syllables are the only means to counteract the evil effects of Kali Yuga. In all the Vedas, it is seen that to cross the ocean of nescience, there is no alternative to the chanting of the holy name. Similarly, Sri Madhvacharya, while commenting upon the Mundaka Upanishad, has quoted the following verse from the Narayana Samhita. In Dwapar Yuga, one could satisfy Krishna or Vishnu only by worshipping him gorgeously according to the Pancharatriki system. But in the age of Kali, one can satisfy and worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari, simply by chanting the holy name. In his Bhakti Sandarbha, text 284, Srila Jiva Goswami strongly emphasizes the chanting of the holy name of the Lord as follows. Srila Jiva Goswami states that the substance of all the Vedic mantras is the chanting of the holy name of the Lord. Every mantra begins with the prefix Nama Om and eventually addresses by the name of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. By the supreme will of the Lord, there is a specific potency in each and every mantra chanted by great sages like Narada Muni and other rishis. Chanting the holy name of the Lord immediately renovates the transcendental relationship of the living being with the Supreme Lord. To chant the holy name of the Lord, one need not depend upon other paraphernalia, for one can immediately get all the desired results of linking with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. It may therefore be questioned why there is a necessity for initiation or further spiritual activities in devotional service for one who engages in the chanting of the holy name of the Lord. The answer is that, although it is correct that one who fully engages in chanting the holy name need not depend upon the process of initiation generally, Generally, a devotee is addicted to many abominable material habits due to material contamination from his previous life. In order to get quick relief from all these contaminations, it is required that one engage in the worship of the Lord in the temple. The worship of the deity in the temple is essential to reduce one's restlessness due to the contaminations of conditioned life. Thus, Narada, in his Pancharatriki Vidhi, and other great sages have sometimes stressed that since every conditioned soul has a bodily concept of life aimed at sense enjoyment, to restrict the sense enjoyment, the rules and regulations for worshipping the deity in the temple are essential. Srila Rupa Goswami has described that the holy name of the Lord can be chanted by liberated souls, but almost all the souls we have to initiate are conditioned. It is advised that one chant the holy name of the Lord without offenses and according to the regulative principles. Yet, due to their past bad habits, they violate these rules and regulations. Thus, the regulative principles for worship of the deity are also simultaneously essential.
So you can see here how it's very important for the devotee to chant Krishna's name. There's no other way from escaping, especially in Kali Yuga. It says, no other way. That means you can do yoga, you will not work. You do karma yoga, you will not do. You do jnana yoga, you will not work. The only process is to do Harinam, Harinam, Harinam. Okay? So therefore, if anyone's intelligent, that he says, the intelligent person will take up this process immediately. Yeah? Kali Yuga has got an ocean of faults. The only one good thing he has got, that if you chant Krishna's name, then you can overcome all these difficulties.
Yes, Prabhu.
Since I've received this order from my spiritual master, I always chant the holy name. But I thought that by chanting and chanting the holy name, I became bewildered. So this is the process that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is telling us, that if you chant, then you will become spiritually, you know, advanced, that tears will come, you start rolling on the ground. Of course, these things are very, while chanting the holy name of the Lord in pure ecstasy, I lose myself, and thus I cry, I laugh, I cry, dancing. It's like a madman. So the whole idea is to develop love for Krishna. Now, our love due to this material contamination is engulfed in the family, in the country, or in the job, or whatever, in the attachment. But our real love should be reposed onto Krishna. And that we have to revive it. And until we revive it, there's no question of escaping the cycle of birth and death. We, you know, try to put our repose, our faith, something else. So this is how the death works, you know. Can you read, please?
Yes, Prabhu. When the living entity passes from the present body to the next body, which is created by his own karma, he becomes absorbed in the pleasurable and painful sensations of the new body and completely forgets the experience of the previous body. This total forgetfulness of one's previous material identity, which comes about for one reason or another, is called death.
So this is the point here. So what we do now will determine our next birth. So if we are serious, then we should take up the program of chanting Krishna's name very seriously.
Yes,
and there's a good chance.
Yes, this is so because those who have dedicated their lives to the transcendental topics of the personality of Godhead, of whom the Vedic hymns sing, and who are constantly engaged in remembering the lotus feet of the Lord, do not run the risk of having misconceptions even at the last moment of their lives.
At this point here?
Yes, please.
If you do this chanting, keep association of devotees, do service submissively, then you do not run the risk of having misconception even at the last moment of the lives.
Yes, Prabhu.
If you want to become very smart, too smart, then I don't know. I'm sure the Yamaraj will become smarter than you. The Yamadutas, they don't come one person, they come three person. What are you going to do? Correct?
Yes, yes, Prabhu.
Can you read the purport?
Yes, Prabhu. The higher perfection of life is attained by remembering the transcendental nature of the Lord at the last moment of one's life. This perfection of life is possible for one who has learned the actual transcendental nature of the Lord from the Vedic hymns sung by a liberated soul like Shukadeva Goswami or someone in that line of disciplic succession. There is no gain in hearing the Vedic hymns for some mental speculator. When the same is heard from an actual self-realized soul and is properly understood by service and submission, everything becomes transparently clear. Thus, a submissive disciple is able to live transcendentally and continue to the end of life. By scientific adaptation, one is able to remember the Lord even at the end of life. When the power of remembrance is slackened due to the rearrangement of bodily membranes. For a common man, it is very difficult to remember things as they are at the time of death. But by the grace of Lord and his bona fide devotees, the spiritual masters, one can get this opportunity without difficulty. And it was done in the case of Maharaj Parikshit.
So for a common man, it is very difficult to remember things as they are at the time of death.
Yes, Prabhu.
So it requires some practice. But for the devotees, by the grace of the Lord and his bona fide devotees, the spiritual master, one can get this opportunity without difficulty. As was done in the case of Maharaj Parikshit.
Yes, sir.
So if you don't have these two things, this grace of the Lord and his bona fide devotee, especially the spiritual master, then the mind cannot be tamed. This whole thing is the mind, because at the time of death, what the mind thinks, here goes. So Krishna says, if you think of me, then finish. You don't have to come back. Bhagavad Gita, he said very simply. Yes?
Yes, yes.
Sure, you all know. Antakale cha mam eva smaran muktva kalevaram ya prayati satmaham yati nasti atra samsayaha. Samsaya means no doubt, without any doubt. If you think of me, whoever at the end of your life quits his body remembering me alone at once attainment of this, there's no doubt. There is not a doubt. It's, you may doubt, this is your thing, but it cannot fail, just like Ajamil, just like Gajendra. Examples are given. And also examples also given, someone who didn't think, like Bharat Maharaj, he thought of the deer. And that's it, he became a deer. Example is also given. It's not that this is all some mythological story. You know, whole India is called Bharat, after this king Bharat Maharaj. That means that personality existed, correct?
Yes, yes.
You cannot say, you know, just like Krishna says, the next line, next verse, if you don't think of me, whatever you think, you attend that without fail. Whatever state you think, then you attend without fail.
Yes.
So the example of Bharat Maharaj is given, that he thought of the deer, he fell down, and the thought of Puranjan, he thought of his wife, he became, you know, next life. A woman.
Yes, please.
So all examples are showing, if only if you are not intelligent. That is all. That's why fools cannot understand these things. You know, Krishna already said this thing. It's not something that, you know, we have to say. You see, only fools, you know, they cannot understand how this is all happening. Can you read?
Yes, Prabhu. The foolish cannot understand how a living entity can quit his body, nor can they understand what sort of body he enjoys under the spell of the modes of nature. But one whose eyes are trained in knowledge can see all this.
This is the point. We can speak about birth and death or day and night. But if you are foolish, then how you will understand? They require some brain. Unless you are transcendental. Transcendental means you accept Krishna.
The endeavoring transcendentalists who are situated in self-realization can see all this clearly. But those whose minds are not developed and who are not situated in self-realization cannot see what is taking place, though they may try.
When they try also, they cannot understand. Why? Huh? Because they absorb in sense gratification. If a person is absorbed in sense gratification, then Krishna covers his intelligence. There's no possible he can understand.
I am never manifest to the foolish and unintelligent. For them, I am covered by my internal potency. And therefore, they do not know that I am unborn and inexhaustible.
So if they don't know Krishna is unborn and inexhaustible, there's no question of escaping the cycle of birth and death. Yes?
Yes, Prabhu.
Hmm? So all this links up to this one point, that we have to surrender to Krishna and take shelter of him. Then yes, everything will be arranged. But we have come too smart, then forget it. There's no way you can, you know, for millions and millions of lives you are rotting here. There's no way we can come out of this, you see. It's not possible, you know. It's here. There's no way you can figure this out.
Thanks, sir. Sorry, Mataji. Yeah, thanks, Mataji. Yeah. Lijita Mataji, you can read now.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Yeah.
Because a person who has been covered by ignorance since time immemorial is not capable of affecting his own self-realization, there must be some other personality who is in factual knowledge of the absolute truth and can impart this knowledge to him.
So this is what you need. You need a guru. Without help of the guru, there's no possibility at all. Hmm? Huh? Yes. Anybody got? Correct. The only solution is to take shelter of Krishna. You can just chant Hare Krishna and free from this cycle of birth and death. We don't want to do. We are worrying about all kind of petty stuffs. Then we will be sidetracked. Solution is to wake up early in the morning and chant your rounds nicely. And you'll see very quickly you will develop this detachment. An attachment for Krishna. So once you get attached to Krishna, you get attached to Krishna, then you see someone can read.
When one seriously engages in the devotional service of the personality of Godhead, fixing the Lord's lotus feet within one's heart as the only goal of life, one can destroy the innumerable impure desires lodged within the heart as a result of one's previous fruitive work within the three modes of material nature. When the heart is thus purified, one can directly pursue both the Supreme Lord and oneself as transcendental entities. Thus, one becomes perfect in spiritual understanding through direct experience, just as one can directly experience the sunshine through normal, healthy vision.
Yes. What do you say? Hmm?
O Uddhava, greatest of saints, in a dangerous situation, an ordinary person cries, becomes fearful and laments. Although such useless emotions do not change the situation, but activities offered to me without personal motivation, even if they are externally useless, amount to the actual process of releasing.
Yes. You can somehow or other connect to Krishna, calling on him. Although it seems like hopeless, but it's the greatest asset. That's why Krishna says this is the most, this process is the supreme intelligence of the intelligent and the cleverness of the most clever. For by following it, one can in this very life make use of temporary and unreal to achieve me, the eternal reality.
Translation: this process is the supreme intelligence of the intelligent and the cleverness of the most clever. For by following it, one can in this very life make use of temporary and unreal to achieve me, the eternal reality.
Yes. You cannot fail. This process, you cannot fail. There's no failure for anyone. Anyone who go to Krishna, he cannot fail. That is safe, you know. Oh. That's why if anyone is intelligent, he will take up this process immediately.
O King, one who accepts this process of devotional service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead will never blunder on his path in this world. Even while running with eyes closed, he will never trip or fall.
So that, when you have done the worst sin, you know, completely nonsense, you have gone, broken all laws, done the worst things in your life you never imagined.
If one chants the holy name of Hari and then dies because of an accidental misfortune, such as falling from the top of a house, slipping and suffering broken bones while traveling on the road, being bitten by a serpent, being afflicted with pain and high fever, or being injured by a weapon, one is immediately absolved from having to enter hellish life, even though he is sinful.
So at least that much is guaranteed. You will never go to hell. So anybody have any further questions?